I think it's important, at least I feel it's important, for me to talk about how I happen to be here, how I happen to become an artist, how I happen to go from St. Louis to New York to Texas to wherever the hell I've been. And I think it's really important to begin to understand the influences that my family had and my upbringing had. My mother had a tremendous influence on me as a young man. She was a wonderful woman, a very talented musician. She was an abused wife. My father was a mean and nasty man, and hit her, hit me, hit everything that he could. He was an alcoholic and died very sadly. So that really, really was an important thing about me. I'm also left-handed. I'm a Libra. I'm a dreamer. I've had all kinds of problems with other young kids when I was young because I was dreaming out the windows all the time. I spent some time writing poetry, and I think that it might help to get into this my story a little bit if I would read that poetry now.
What do you want to be? My mother asked one night after she'd had a couple, what do you want to be? 'Cause she had reason to worry. I did nothing except read and eat granulated sugar sprinkled over silky butter hidden in folded Wonder Bread, the sugar unleashing a sweet spit flood as I chewed. An artist, I said. No, she said, they never have enough money, so pick something else. And I looked at me and saw it was hopeless. I had sweet-made cavities and a butterfat roll at my waist, fashioned as a dough plug to fill the hole in my heart that had been battered by my father. I knew I'd need a lifetime to learn when to say when. Be careful, she told me, her eyes reddened with tears, what you wish for, 'cause if you want too much, you'll never have to live with regret, dreams being deadly in both construct and destruct. If you want nothing, you'll never know disappointment. The Roshi of lack, she watered my garden with her lament. Original sin turned out not to be original at all, but simply the container my father's fist and my mother's fears fashioned for me, which I struggled using every tool that came to hand to burst, to leave, like the autumn cicadas, a husk hanging on the bark. Or, as does the snake, discarded skin, opalescent evidence of transcendence. Escape proving impossible, I've had to embrace what couldn't be fled, but now watch with glee as that original wish comes true, being written all over my face.
Yeah, my name is Paul Kohl, and I'm a photographer. I have been one for many years. I'm from the United States. I was born in a city called St. Louis, which is in the middle of the country. And like other people, other artists from St. Louis who left, I left when I was young. I went to New York City when I was 18. Quietly took a suitcase out of my mother's closet. She was sleeping in the bedroom at the time. Packed my bags and snuck out of the house. I was nice enough to leave letters behind for my mother and the people that I owed things to. And I walked very quietly into this, it's the middle of the night, you know, and I had to go into town, in this little town close to where I'd lived, in order to get my money out of the bank. I had saved money working in the grocery store. And so I fell asleep between two buildings, and then it began to rain. And I got up with my suitcase, it's still like 4 a.m. And I walked into this motel and asked the motel owner if I could possibly rest on his couch. And he said, he was nice enough to let me camp out there. So I fell asleep on the couch. Next thing I know, he's kicking me and saying, it's time to get up and get out. So 9 o'clock, I walked to the bank, or 10 o'clock, or whenever the damn thing opened. And I was very conscious I had to get out of town before anybody found me. My parents, would know I was gone by this time, and I had to get my money, get on a bus or whatever I was going to do and get out of town. So I managed to get my money out of the bank and got on a Greyhound and left for New York City.
Suddenly, I was staring into the dark, the ceiling floating above the bed, just discernible in the gloom. Outside, the bare trees rattled like loose bones in a bag. Inside, the house creaked in complaint at the weight of the frozen air clotting on the windows, provoking prisms from the simple-minded moon. Mom's breathing drew me out of my covers cocoon to where she stood at the second story's window, staring out at the street lamp's luminescent cone. His car, recently returned, squatted in the light. The cooling engine, crackling like brittle sticks, snapped across a knee. The windshield frosting as we watched his beetled back just visible, slumped over the steering wheel, stuporous in the frozen night. We stood while our warm breath frosted circles on the glass, the heat from our arms where we leaned against each other, binding us like gravity, holding us as we mothed around the candle flame of simply going back to bed, the incandescence of which left me panting and explained the unshed tears in her eyes when she looked at me and said, "I should go get the son of a bitch before he froze to death."
I worked in a portrait studio in New York for a few years. Then the Army grabbed me during the Vietnam War. I served in Vietnam as a conscientious objector. I was a medic. When you're in the Army and you're in a war, if you have a little bit of training, you sort of get kicked up. So I was doing stuff that a doctor would do. I'd set bones, I did minor surgery, I delivered babies, I did all kinds of stuff. I went to school for a year and then went to Vietnam, spent a year there, almost getting killed several times, but managing, luckily, to get back to the States. They sent me back to California, which I could hardly believe. I then went, after the Army, I went to art school in San Francisco. And that was a major, major event in my life. I was able to study with some great photographers. Robert Frank was there, Ralph Gibson was there, Larry Clark was there, Phil Perkis, Art Fried, the list goes on and on and on. And these people were, are active artists. They were still making work. And so you could sit with them and you could talk and they would look at your work. And it was just a profoundly wonderful experience. Great teachers, my fellow students there were just really exciting, interesting people to be around. So I really loved it and grew tremendously from that experience. At that time, the Art Institute's photography department has started under the influence of Ansel Adams, had a great deal to do with it. So there was that tradition of fine art printmaking that Ansel Adams fostered. Edward Weston had been up there. So lots of really, really great people. When I got there, from my experience, I was really not in the mood to follow anybody's lead. So I tried going in the opposite direction. Instead of working with view cameras, I worked with 35 millimeter rangefinders with really, really fast film. I would overexpose it like crazy. I would develop it with really concentrated developers so that my negatives would end up being very, very thick, very dense, which means that when you get in the dark room, you have to get light through that density onto paper, and the resulting image would be very grainy. There would be lots of salt and pepper qualities to the print. And I really tried working very hard with that, using it as a graphic tool, because I also didn't want subject matter to become an important part of my pictures. And I wanted the pictures to be all about the process. So I wanted the photographic presence to be the primary evidence left in the print itself. I remember when I went to New York as a kid and walking down the street and just trying to believe the fact that I could be what I wanted to be, and looking at the buildings and constantly looking around and saying, I have eyes. I have eyes. Photography has given me eyes. I can see. I can see. Whereas before, I didn't know that. And the idea that if you take all of your emotion and you put it into a medium, you use the medium as a vehicle for releasing all of that pent up, wasted stuff that's sort of eating at your soul. So you can externalize it. And as you externalize it, you get rid of it, and then you find out new things that are inside of you. And so art is this continuous act of peeling away of layers, getting, there's no center. You just keep working on the layers. And eventually, I don't know what happens, eventually you die, but I keep getting clearer and clearer about what it is that I see, why I see, how I see. And so I think that I am now becoming the medium. The medium is taking over. You lose yourself. You become the process. So I think that anybody that wants to become an artist must be willing to sort of give up their personality and embrace this medium, whatever medium it might be, and become it. If you're a young artist, you have to work so hard that you disappear inside of the work. And when that happens, when you learn the technique, when your technique is second nature to you, when you don't even think about it, it's just there. It's there. And everywhere you look, it's there. The world is transparent to you. It's a magic moment. After the Art Institute, I won a National Endowment for the Arts grant, luckily enough, and that allowed me to go to Japan. That's another major turning point in my life. I lived in Japan for 3 or 4 years, met my wife, practiced a martial art called Aikido very intensely, did photography, eventually had to come back to the United States, and to my own disappointment, I had to go back to St. Louis to take care of my parents, who both got ill. I lived in St. Louis for several years with my then wife. We then moved to Indiana, where I went to graduate school. I had a couple of kids by then and needed to get a solid degree, so I got my master's there and then began teaching. I went to the Maryland Institute College of Art, taught photography. I knew that I could not do commercial work. I tried it, and again, talk about failures. I was an abysmal commercial photographer, forgetting to put film in the camera, botching the development processes. As soon as it was no longer my emotional connection to the medium, I'd lost interest, and I would screw it up in some way or another. So I ended up going back to graduate school. I was also interested very much in the sort of postmodern revolution that was beginning at that time, or evolution, if you will. Also color. I had never done any color work of any consequence. I wanted to try and see what that was like. So I went back to graduate school, and there I started experimenting with dye transfer printing. Which I do a brief explanation is a color process that involves separating the colors into their primaries, red, green, and blue, and recording the red information, green information, blue information on separate pieces of negative that you then convert to a positive using this stuff called matrix film. And matrix film is then soaked in cyan, magenta, and yellow dyes. Then the amount of dye that's taken up by the matrix film depends on the amount of exposure that that area has gotten. More exposure, more density. It's like a sponge, if you will. So then you take those three separate dye records, cyan, magenta, and yellow, and you transfer them onto a piece of paper using a pH difference between the matrix film and the paper transfer, so that the dye migrates onto the paper. So you transfer one, take it off, put another one on in register, roll it out, let the dye transfer. You end up with a three-color print that is really, really quite beautiful. Ansel Adams used to talk about the idea of pre-visualization in photography, which means that as you look at the world, you can put frame lines around things, and you can see reality as if it were a print. Alfred Stieglitz talked about the idea of equivalence, where you look through the camera and you find something outside of you that is an emotional equivalent to what you're feeling. So I think both of those ideas are interesting. They're old, but they're still valid. The medium is indeed the message. The vehicle, the artist is the vehicle. The artist's life is the canvas, and you continue to paint on it your entire being. And hopefully, as time goes on, you get clearer and clearer. You start off being angry, and you end up being translucent. And I'm still working towards that translucency and to let the medium express itself more and more clearly through me. For me, teaching in the darkroom all day, intensely involved in all of the wet processes of photography. After I finished, I didn't have any energy left for my own work, and so I began looking for other ways to do things, and I began writing, and this is when I started to write poetry. I also wrote a couple of novels, unpublished, but I really loved the process of writing. It also got me involved in computers. How you take an image from the computer, scan it, manipulate it, and then how do you output it? Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, the rock and roll group, Graham Nash was also doing this sort of work and got hold of a big printer that was being used in Hollywood by the Disney people to make a hard cover or hard output of their early digital animation experiments. And he did some printing using that machine. I saw some of the results of that, and it would just absolutely blew me away. So I became interested in that process. And at this point, it was 1996, and I was chairman of the department at the Maryland Institute of the Photography Department. I had been faculty president. I was very heavily involved in the administrative stuff going on there, but wasn't able to make a living. Art schools in the United States pay abysmally. I had a wife and two children, and we weren't able to live a decent life, and made the very difficult decision to leave the United States and move back to Japan, which we did in 1996. But in those days, when I went back to Japan, I had to stop doing photography. So I went with my family. I began teaching at Temple University in Tokyo. I taught web design. I taught a sort of photography class, but it was really a graphics class because there was no output. The only way to get output in those days was to send your work to a commercial printer, and that's really not very interesting at all. I taught English as well. So I did all kinds of things and then just began making a living and supporting my family and working as a peripatetic intellectual, a knowledge worker. I would go every place that needed some, that if I knew something and they needed it, I would go there and teach it.
The shirt I wore only once. The sleeves, as with everyone I buy, too long and it had fucking French cuffs to boot. It was sky blue to match, my mother said, my eyes, and would be just the thing, because I had been beaten in the school bathroom, dreamed out the windows while the nuns droned on about suffering. Christ knows that I hadn't been invited to the class party my parents were chaperones for, and if that weren't just too much, my grades were going in the toilet where I had been cornered, whipped with wet handkerchiefs for the foul crime of dreaming out the window, and there I was with an IQ through the roof. So the shirt, being sky blue to match my eyes, said my mother, would, being the latest thing, make me popular, get me in the parties, pull the shades on the windows out which I dreamed, and stop the downward trajectory of my young life. But I hated that shirt, too long in the arms, with its kiss ass up to the minute collar and color to match my eyes that were really red with rage at the shock of being out in the blue. And what I really wanted was to spit in their soup, piss in their shoes, and fuck the trajectory of my young life.
The difficult part of that is that when we went to Japan, originally, when we moved, we dropped our two children into Japanese schools. And it was one of those sort of sink or swim things. Very, very difficult for them. They are American. They are Americanized. They were American kids going into a Japanese school system, which is very, very different. And it is everything you have heard it to be. It was very difficult for them. They suffered. But the idea was that we had to make them learn the language, both reading and writing, and to come to understand that they were bicultural kids. They're not, my wife is Japanese. I'm an American, and they're a mixture of those two things. And they needed to have that experience. So they did. They did it for a couple of years in Japanese schools, and then they began becoming Japanese, which is not what we wanted to have happen anyway. They're not totally American, they're not totally Japanese, and they would never be either. So we took them out of Japanese schools, moved to Kobe, where they could go to an international school. I began working at a university which was 3.5 hours by the bullet train from Kobe, which meant that I would go on a Sunday, teach the week, living in a tiny little apartment with a two-burner stove and a toilet that looked like an airplane toilet. I did that for 6 years. 6 years I would commute until my kids finished, both of them finished high school, and both ended up going back to the United States to universities. Once that was done, my wife could join me, and life became normal again. But for those 6 years, I spent the time traveling back and forth twice a week, living by myself, speaking very little to anybody because my Japanese is rudimentary. Very few people spoke English. The Japanese are a relatively closed and private people. So I spent most of my time by myself. But what that allowed me to do was to begin to work on my photography again. I had spent the first couple of years in Japan not being able to do that because of no access to any darkroom facilities. At the university, I built a small darkroom, began developing film. I got research grants that allowed me to begin investigating big Epson printers and using all black inks as an output. I went to do residencies at a Japanese paper maker in southern Japan, where they make handmade paper that had an inkjet coated surface. The place is called Awagami, and it makes beautiful, beautiful paper. And I began having some real successes at that point, and my work, I think, took a great leap. I was back to using 35mm rangefinder cameras, 120 cameras as well, developing the film myself, and then scanning it using high quality film scanners, and then outputting to large inkjet prints. And really, really loved that process. And that's sort of taken me to where I am today, still working with large Epson printers, using John Cohn's all black ink sets and printing to high quality French paper. It was really, really a wonderful time, even though I spent it mostly by myself, living like a monk, dedicated totally to my photography and to making a living, seeing my family on the weekends. And I'm now living in Singapore. All this time I've been teaching photography, making art, having exhibitions. Izumi and I, my wife and I, left Japan really happily. It was time to go. And we went to Singapore. I am now teaching there in the university. I have been there, I don't know, 6-7 years now. The photography department was brand new when I started. There's been a lot of evolution. I'm still working with large inkjet prints. I've been back and worked with John Cohn at the Cohn Editions. I keep a connection to him. I work with his inks. I think time for another change is coming. Now, where that change is going to take me, I'm not really sure. I've done three books. I did a book on India, did a book on Japan. I'm now finishing a book on Portugal. I love Lisbon. So we're thinking a lot about where our next move is, and who knows. So I think that my work is going well. I'm dedicated to photography in a way that is deep and will continue. I still do a lot of writing. I still do a lot of experimentation. I still do a lot of teaching, but things are good. I'm grateful. Thank you. Cut. Okay, cut.